Excellent. Good. Masal Khair and good evening. Thank you all for being here tonight. And a special thank you to ACOR for putting together this lecture series. I am truly honored to be part of this project as well as a colleague of ACOR and Shep. So just jump right in. Wadi Rum is your iconic desert landscape. It's your beauty, the majesty of this place, the grandness of it, is really only bested by just the sheer size. In this place, geomorphologically speaking, it is a textbook, quintessential Inselberg impediment landscape, meaning you have these grand mountaintops with a flat valley in between, and you throw in the ergs and the dune fields, and it creates this landscape, this place that's so otherworldly that it's been featured in several films to stand in as other planets. You have Mars in The Martian in 2015. You have it stand in for the LV-223 in the Prometheus, which is the prequel to the Alien series. You have it standing in even for religious and holy sites like the planet Jeddah in the new Star Wars Rogue One story. But not only does it play this role in these fictional landscapes, but it also has been featured in several historical fiction stories like Thebes that tell just these very powerful stories. And the story is only enhanced by the landscape, the places where these movies are filmed. And of course, you have the quintessential Lawrence of Arabia, which has brought fame to Wadi Rum for decades. And so in these films, the beauty and the majesty of the landscape are very heavily featured, but something that's often overlooked is the immense cultural heritage that can be found in the valley. You have a testament of human occupation and resilience living in these marginal landscapes, in this desert arid environment. And that testimony is told through relics, like this hammerstone, or in buildings and footprints that can be easily distinguished, like the Nabataean temple, as well as the countless Neolithic, not countless, but the Neolithic sites that can be found throughout the valley. But the vast majority of the story, the history of Wadi Rum is told in the stone. It's told in the rocks, it's in the images. You have hunting scenes with lions and ostriches, things that are just so wild to imagine in that landscape today. You also have this incredible overlapping of these histories. Not only do they exist, but they exist in this continuation. You have Neolithic rock art with the Mudic written over it, with Arabic written over that, with modern Arabic names, and you even find depictions of rifles. And just the stories that is written in the stone make the rock art in Wadi Rum truly incredible resources. And they're so important that they're actually among the main reason why Wadi Rum was inscribed in 2011 as a UNESCO World Heritage Site. It's actually a dual site, so it's a cultural heritage site as well as a natural heritage site. It's one of the very few in the world that can hold this distinction, and largely because of the rock art. Two of the three criteria that the decision was based upon to include Wadi Rum in UNESCO were human-based. It was the richness of the resources themselves, the rock art, but also the location and the interaction of these resources with the landscape that tell the story and create not only a cultural resource, but a cultural landscape. And so the two of the three are very heavily related to the rock art. But unfortunately, there are some challenges to the protection of them. As you can see in this picture, all that white outline is residue from someone applying a rubbing or trying to take an imprint of the rock art, peeling it off and leaving this residue behind. And not only does it damage the rock art aesthetically, but it also makes it much more vulnerable for decay and risks its longevity into the future. And so with that, there are several challenges that are currently being presented to the Wadi Rum Protected Authority, as well as the governing Aziza. And the first has to do with the fact that Wadi Rum initially was a nature preserve. And it was established in 1996. It was meant to protect the landscape, protect the beauty, protect the grandness of it. And because of that, a lot of the policies that were created are on this grander landscape scale. Things like managing jeep tracks, trying to get rid of illegal camps, missed land use by tourists, visitor impact. But none of these really focus specifically on the rock art themselves, the immense cultural heritage resources that you can find in the valley. And so, as kind of part of that, another concern that has been brought up is this lack of integration between that cultural and the natural. Some of the things that make Wadi Rum so unique, that interaction, that relationship. And so I'm sure some of you are familiar with the Mega J or the Mega Jordan. There's a purpose-built GIS geodatabase with junction with the Getty Institute as a means to locate, identify, and categorize different archaeological sites throughout Jordan. And it's a powerful tool. It has allowed for a lot of spatial assessment, but it has limitations. So places like Wadi Rum, when the rock art panels are so dense and so closely connected to each other, a map like this would be useless. You wouldn't be able to get any information out of it, you just have a bunch of dots. And so also the implementation of the Mega J can be a little tedious. Filling in forms, setting them in. If you're assessing over 100 sites in a day, to go back to your station, fill out the form for every single panel, wait for it to get uploaded manually, it's just not realistic. It's time and cost sensitive. And so there was a need for a new approach for how to incorporate GIS technology and geotechnologies into rock art assessment and management. Another complication that's a bit more delicate are tribal disputes, economic competition. There are several main families that live in and around the Wadi Rum region, and sometimes there are conflicts. This panel was recently completely painted white. As we were told, the story goes is that someone in one family was upset that this popular tourist destination was getting more attention than rock art sites in their territory, and so they vandalized this to redirect tourism. This kind of behavior is completely unacceptable, and it creates a major challenge. Vandalism has been one of the more pressing and theological concerns and challenges that are much more complicated to address. The last point that UNESCO has brought up concerns is the lack of international cooperation. And so wanting to bring in new knowledge, new skills, trying to increase the research capacity of the Wadi Rum protected area. And so this is really where we come in. This is where SHET comes in, and we are honored to be working with the Wadi Rum Authority as well as Aziza. And so, SHET. As Dr. Corbett already briefly introduced, SHET is focused primarily on enhancing local capacity for being able to be directly involved in the management and conservation of their heritage. And these are largely underserved communities, people that are often overlooked for employment because they're underskilled, several other challenges. And so we really wanted to focus on making it so that way these people can take ownership, be empowered, be able to really interact and be part of the research, not just watching a scholar come in, do research, publish a paper in some journal that they'll never read, and then leave, not having seen any kind of an impact. This we can actually feel it, touch it, participate. And that's really the power of SHET, and it really is humbling to be part of it. There are several current sites of SHET right now, and they range all the way from Umm Jamal up in Mafraq to the Gora Safi in the Wadi Araba, the Temple of Living Lions in Petra, and our little spot of heaven down in Wadi Rum. So our group, our project, lovingly called CBRAR, because it's the cultural-based rock art and epigraphy recording project, CBRAR. Basically, we are a team, a diverse team of international and local scholars ranging a variety of fields, we have geographers, geomorphologists, hydrographers, archaeologists, and then myself that kind of fits somewhere in the cracks of the heritage science. And so we wanted to make sure that we weren't trying to reinvent the wheel. We're not trying to survey sites that have already been surveyed somewhere. We didn't want to be stepping on anyone's toes because there is remarkable work that has been done in Wairoa. Remarkable scholarly archaeological work, epigraphy work, such as that of Dr. Glenn. And so we didn't want to kind of redo their work. We wanted to build. We wanted to build on the knowledge that was already there and make it usable to people living in the valley. And so part of that was the rock art stability assessment. We're looking at the geologic stability of individual panels, which is a discrete rock surface with inscriptions or rock art, as well as looking at their visual and aesthetic quality. On top of that, we also wanted to incorporate training in geotechnologies, things that can be applied not only to rock art, but to other skills, other forms of employment that could be useful in the valley, archaeological digs. Even some of the techniques we were using were actually designed for city planning, urban planning, and different tools like that. So it's giving them the skills that can be applied to heritage, but also beyond. And then as part of that kind of accumulating is the Rock Art Rangers tour guide program, which allowed our documentation team plus other tour guides in the region to get training in basic epigraphy, the geologic history of the valley, the occupational history of the valley, and give them the knowledge and the skills to be able to run an official rock art tour through the Wairoa protected area as a way of validating all of the work that they've done previously building up to this point. So we're going to go through just a little bit of the different techniques that we used. The first is the Rock Art Stability Index, or RASI. This is a rapid field method for quickly assessing the stability, like I said, the stability as well as the aesthetics of the rock art. And it's non-invasive. It's all observationally based, so you don't have to damage the rock, you don't have to take samples, you don't have to do all these other overly complicated techniques. And it's specifically designed for the non-specialist so that you can have the management of the site directly involved, such as Aziza and the WRPA. And it also comes with relatively easy understood analyses where the lower score equals a higher stability. It's like golf, you want as low as possible. You have a maximum score of 100, so you're scoring from 0 to 100, so it's something that can be very quickly, easily understood. And on top of that, you even have score categories that are descriptive, ranging from excellent status, critical status, and everything in between. So as a manager, you can go through, see which sites are in the most danger, and then respond accordingly. So how does this work? Basically, the RASI assesses over 36 specific rock decay features scaled on 0 to 3, 0 being not present, 3 being dominating panel. And so researchers are trained to identify every single one and rate it on a scale of 0 to 3. These are fit within 5 categories. So you have a site setting, which is looking at the whole rock, geologic setting, fissures. Impending loss is looking for features that indicate that decay might be coming in the future. And so, you have pieces of stone that are on the surface that are preparing to detach would be recorded in this section. You have your large event loss, which are your high impact, low frequency event, things like rock fall, fire, don't happen very often, but when they do, it's a big deal. You have incremental loss, which is generally from millimeter to centimeter range, which is where most rock decay actually occurs. And so this section is significantly larger than the others, but it's looking at flaking, pitting, and using as many descriptive terms as we can so that way it's easy for people without rock decay training to understand. And then rock coatings, which is a little tricky because sometimes rock coatings are beneficial, so they actually have a negative score to bring your score down. And on top of that, we also have a qualitative category which allows the scholar to input things that are significant in terms of management, but maybe not so much for the scoring of the panel itself. So if you're recording a panel and you've got goats all around you, that could be a problem. Like, where are you going to put goats in your rock decay index? you put it in this third category, this sixth category.
So for our project in Wadi Rum, we started off first with your typical classroom training where we went through each element. And thankfully, one of our local scholars, Dr. Ziad Salameen from Hussein Mintilal University in Petra, as well as Mohammed Mayan, one of our main core team members, had already introduced our team of documentation team, which included our quorum team members, our site steward, and then 9 local tour guides and high school graduates. So they had already kind of introduced them to the different elements, so the training went rather quickly. After we were in the house, we went into the field and figured them out as well, again, pointing them out, giving them solid examples. And after that, they were asked to self-lead themselves, to work as a group, to identify, see what each other is seeing, to make sure everyone's seeing the same thing. And it can be quite entertaining to watch. Oh, no. Basically, it's fun hearing them use these geologic terms, and then our site steward in the fedora translating it into Arabic, and then the whole group, fi, hunak, la, si, ah. We were trying to figure out how it would be scored, and it was really very, very exciting how quickly they took to the Rasi. So we started as a group first, the first day. The second day, they were broken into small groups and kind of discussing what they see and what they didn't see. And the morning of the third day, the Rasi experts were sitting there trying to decide if it would be best to go into pairs, to do small groups for another time. Oh, we'll just see. We get into the field, and they take off. They grab their sheets, they grab their phones, they go out, and they just start recording, and it was the most incredible thing. I've worked with the Rasi for years, and I've never seen a group take to it like these guys did. And it was really, really cool. They were excited, they were engaged. It was something that they could do. Now, unfortunately, one of the biggest cripples to Rasi is Rasi. Oops. This is a Rasi sheet. Traditionally, it's been paper like this. I know you can't really read it, but that's kind of the point. We have done in the past where we print out thousands of these, take them with us into the field, hand them out. One is filled out for each panel, get back home. Someone has to manually input it into a database. It's a hassle. It's a mess. And we didn't want to do that here. Thankfully, we were able to translate it, so we have an English-Arabic, and it was very useful as a reference. But thanks to my wonderful colleague, George, we did not have to do that this time, because he was able to incorporate several different geotechnologies in a way that has just redefined Rasi and what it can do, which is really exciting for me. Some of them are the collector and survey apps on your phone, smartphone. He also established a group on ArcGIS online, which made it accessible, as well as GigaPan photography, which is a supplemental advanced photography. So the collector and the survey are on your phone, and I actually have 2 phones that has both programs on it. So after the lecture, if you want to take a closer look, please let me know. But essentially, it's taking this sheet of paper and putting it in a database that you go through on your phone. So you add a point, put in your name, go through the list, Mafi. That's bad Arabish right there, Arabic. We started with the collector app, but the drop-down menu seemed to be a bit cumbersome, and so for this mission in August, George was able to work with the survey 123, which is really simple. You just hit the bullets on what the score is, and it was excellent. And I think one of its biggest strengths was that it was familiar. You were using technology that you already knew. And these guys know Facebook inside and out, and so having something on your phone wasn't this foreign technology that they had to relearn.
And so it was something that they could get their hands around. And for the students that didn't have smartphones, because not everybody does, our project was able to acquire 3 Samsung tablets that were donated to the team, so that way everyone could have a chance to participate,
such as this one here.
And so when you do your assessment on the phone and then you upload it to the cloud, it goes into the GIS online. And this was really important to us, that you could use the data immediately. So when you do your assessment, upload it to the cloud, it's right there. I can get on my computer and see it right there. And so you can immediately use it. It's user-friendly, so it's not overly complicated. Anyone who's done anything with GIS knows that it just makes you want to rip your hair out. But the GIS online created kind of a more user-friendly interface, and it also allows for direct post-field editing. And this is something that it definitely has over the Mega J, because Mega J, someone else is doing the editing. Someone else is in charge of that geo database. And so if you're doing something, you upload a point but forget to add a photo, you're kind of screwed. You have to send it as an addendum and hope that they get it. Whereas here, the post-field editing allows you to have direct control. You do your points, you upload it, you come home, you realize it's on the other side of the street, so you just edit the point and move it over. And it gives you that involvement, those skills. And then also, much like the collector in the Survey 123, these are technological skills that, while we're applying them to rock art, aren't limited to rock art. They can use these skills in other ways as well. So for this project, all of our core team members, as well as some of the SHEP staff, were given access to this database. And that also is helpful for people like me who want to be involved year-round, but I have another job I have to do. Unfortunately, can't live in Jordan and play in Wadi Rum all year. And so this allows me to kind of answer questions, be involved, keep track of what's being done where, and I can get online and I can see a point that maybe Hussein dropped last week, and I can keep up with it, so I can stay involved. And another big component is that it does not require software on your computer. There are a lot of times where you have to have GIS software, you have to have the program, you have to have a license, all sorts of messes with GIS. And with online, you just have a sign-in with a password. And so anywhere you have internet, I can get to this on my phone. And so it makes that information accessible immediately. So, what's the power of this? What's the so what? Remember this map I showed earlier? This is Mega J. These are the sites that are recorded in Wadi Rum by the Mega J. These are the sites that have been recorded by our guys that have been supplemented with the survey information that was done by Ahmed Lash, his team from the Department of Antiquities. It's so crowded you can't even see them all. So you zoom in a little bit and you start to see how many sites we have there. And of these sites, these are all the ones that have rock art individual panels that have been assessed. So the blue are the collector app. Those were done during our April season. And the green is the survey, which were done during our August season. And so through collector, we have collected over 350 individual panels. In survey, we've done almost 100. And so together, in a matter of weeks, we've been able to assess over 400 panels in Wadi Rum in 2 weeks. And so this is really the power of it. And not only that, you can look at these. So if you're online and you're on the interface and you want to see that point, click it. It brings up the RASI score. It brings up who recorded it, the date, the panel number, what the individual scores are. And it's the same thing for the 123, where you can have the photos attached to it. So not only do you know where it is, you know how it's scored, who scored it, and a picture to verify that score, all in one place that everyone can access. That's powerful. And it's also the database itself. So say you want to get a little bit beyond the map, you want to look at the database. This is what you're looking at. You can scroll through. You can see the aspect. Over here you have the names. And then you can scroll through all the different elements of RASI, every single one. And then the descriptive category that you can fill in or not fill in, depending on if there's an issue.
the additional rock coatings. You give them the final score. So you can sort by score, you can sort by name, sort by site. And we also added a section of epigraphic notes. What's it a picture of? What's the script? And then you can look at the photo. It takes a while to load because it's a computer, so it always does. But right there, that's the score we were just looking at. That's that panel that Muhammad scored on the 16th. And it's all there. And also, you can change the styles. So not only can you see where they are, you can score by what's the final score. So you can symbolize it by size to show here in Ain Shalala, although there's this cluster up near the beginning of the trail, they're not as unstable as the ones at the spring themselves. You can see the spatial distribution. And you can mark it a different way. Maybe you didn't like the size, you can go for color. So here's the different colors. Over here at Hashim al-Bahur, there's obviously something going on that southern tip. And so as a manager, imagine being able to see these maps, color-code it, and immediately know which panels are at risk and which ones aren't. You go to a place like Khazali, famous, the go-to rock art place in Wadi Rum. There's this cluster, right? Okay. The darker points that are a little further up, those are the panels that are above the walkway. And then in Khazali, it's kind of counterintuitive because you would think that the ones that are right at people height would be in the most danger, but Khazali's a little strange and it's intrigued me and my other geoscientist colleagues as to why. But it's a pattern, and you see it immediately when you look at this map. And so on top of that, we also have supplemental technology, particularly gigapan photography. So essentially, gigapan photography is a high, super high resolution panoramic photography. So this might look like just your standard panorama. This was taken by Mohammed Bayan, one of our core team members. And it's just, yeah, cool. Can't really see where the rock art is. So let's zoom in. Kind of looks like a camel. Let's go see. Here's a camel. You get in here and you're like, oh, there's the Semitic script in there. I wonder what it says. So you zoom in again. Imagine trying to get that kind of clarity from this photo if it were a standard panorama. And so we were able to donate a DSLR camera, the robotic arm for the GigaPan technology, as well as we're renting a tripod from Acor that is then being...
That's a JT a day.
Sorry. But it's allowing the team to do a GigaPan like this at every single site that we recorded. So on top of the GIS, on top of the RASI scores, on top of the accessibility on their phones, they have access to this kind of photography as well. And so all of that together really makes for great management of the site, leads to a great, better understanding of what is happening at the site so that the management can respond accordingly. But beyond that, something that surprised me as a geographer, as a geomorphologist, I come from rock decay science. I don't really care what this says, just that it has been said and that it will continue to say down the road. But part of our program that was from our local scholars here are both epigraphers, and it was really important to them that these guys kind of understand, our documentation team has a basic understanding of what these scripts say. And man, it was phenomenal. They loved it. We would get to a site, we would get out, and me and my RASI colleagues would start labeling out which panels are what, and we would turn around, and they're all huddled around this inscription, reading it, picking out the letters, picking out what it says, trying to sound out the names, and they just, it was incredible. They really took to it and were excited about it. I mean, there was an evening when one of our core members came to our house and brought his daughter, his 8-year-old daughter, and she sat on the stoop of our house and wrote her name in fluid. Because they were so excited. Not only did this script, not only was it a tourist resource, was it a cultural resource, was it part of their history, but it became alive.
they could read it, they could interact with it, and it created this personal connection with the rock art, with these inscriptions that I certainly didn't see coming. And it was incredible because it was reflected in the care that they took when doing the assessment. All of a sudden, this was no longer squibbles. This was a camel drawn by Hussein bin Muhammad bin. And it was something that was part of their history, their active history. And so the epigraphy, that dual approach of not only the rock science, the rock decay science, the geosciences, and the epigraphy really lynched it all together and became something that they could really own. It was empowering to them that this was their heritage, and now they can interact with it, they can read it. That's not to say there haven't been challenges. Every project has challenges. One of our biggest ones was actually a matter of translation. The Rassi has some complicated terminology, and initially, we translated them word for word. Direct translations don't work, but it was a start. And so as we were getting into the field and recognizing, once they started understanding what this feature actually was supposed to be, we were able to sit down and find just the right word. And so it was this active, interactive translation of this resource that they can now continue to use. Vandalism and land use continues to be a problem, as well as the mindset surrounding vandalism. This is the effects of a bullet impact on one of the panels. And I remember talking to one of the guys, yeah, gunshots, they're bad. Of course they're bad. He's like, yeah, but it's just a small hole. When you understand rock decay science like I do, you see these radiating cracks and you know this is way more than just on the surface. You have all these dusts, the dust gets into the fissures, those fissures expand, this whole thing. It's not just the hole, it's the rock. And so it's that mindset that, oh, it's just a little problem, needs change. And with RACSI, when you're assessing these little problems and you see how these little problems add up, hopefully it can help change that mindset. As well as graffiti and tagging and putting your names on things. And this is also kind of a delicate, tricky situation because you think about what makes Wadi Rum so unique. And it is this timeline and continuation of culture over culture over culture. And so you do have to ask the theoretical question, how much of this is just a continuation of that culture? And how much, where is that line? I mean, we'd be out in the field and we'd be trying to decide if something is old or new, and one of the guys would come over like, oh yeah, that's my uncle, that's new. It happens. We had one of our team members who were at a site and quite sheepishly kind of walked up to me and he's, it's me. that mindset of it's okay. It's also not just the locals but tourists, foreigners coming in and saying, I was here, Susie was here. And when you have graffiti and vandalism as in a concentrated area, it almost creates this perception of social acceptability, like at the very end of Hazali Canyon. Once you get to the very, very end, you don't really have any more of those inscriptions, the old ones, but it's literally graffiti. You've got, you know, dates of 2014, and you have Muhammad from Oman, 2015, and it's created kind of this culture that's okay, because there is so much of it. And so I've actually been working with colleagues with Shep and hopefully trying to create kind of a sister project to bring specialists in to teach local community members how to remove this, remove spray paint, charcoal, other forms of graffiti as a way of deterring the future. Because people are a lot less likely to vandalize a clean surface than they are something that's already messed up. So that continues to be a problem. Another challenge that we saw was a matter of diversity in our team. Our site steward and our key core members are all from the village of Rum. And there's way more families than just the family that lives in Rum Village. And so as we're moving forward with the project, we are going to be very intentional about including more people from surrounding villages like Disa and people that have connections to the heritage in Rum, which not, might not necessarily live in Rum, but still have stakes in it. Still have, we want to make sure that more than just the people living in Rum Village can benefit from this project, because more than the people in Rum Village rely on Wadi Rum and have a connection to Wadi Rum. So we want to make sure that more people are included. That said, these guys are amazing. We had, this is our typical late afternoon when the sun started getting way too hot, so we'd huddle in the shade and have tea and then call it a day. And we did this every day. And there was this element of friendship, colleagues, that developed among the crew. And sometimes we just had fun. That was just a spur of the moment thing. It just happened. Someone was humming something. Someone else, oh, let's do that thing that we do. We call the camels. And then next thing we know, we've got this whole performance going. That was typical of this group. We had fun. And that really, I think, added to the positive image of this research. And so these methods are now associated with a positive experience, which can then help lead into the future. So the future projects. First thing we want to create, we're going to use the translations that we got with our team, so locally translated, to create an English-Arabic Grassi reference manual. So this is not to replace training, to emphasize that many, many times. It's a reference for those who have already been trained, so that way they can remember, they can get a description. If they can't quite, what's splintering again? I always get it confused. They can look it up, they can have pictures, they can have a description in English and a description in Arabic. We already have this drafted. By the end of the project, hopefully we'll have it complete and used as a resource for the Wadi Rum protected area, as well as the Rock Art Tour Guide program. We are starting that in October based on our results from the documentation phase, which started in July, continued through August, and will continue until the end of September. We've actually tasked the documentation team of collecting another 500 pounds. And that might seem like a lot, but like I said, we were able to document over 300 panels in 2 weeks. I think they can handle 500 a month and shovel one. But part of that is leading into the Rock Art Rangers program, where these guys that have been on the documentation team can then take ownership and kind of play a more leadership role in training local tour guides and be part of the leadership of the next phase of documentation teams, the next phase of Rock Art Rangers, the next phase of people who are excited about the heritage that they have in the valley. And that's one of the really cool things that we've seen already, is that one of our key members, Mohammed Mayan, who's played a critical role in our project, admitted to me that before this started, he didn't really care about rock art. It was just something that was there. He didn't really care. But now you would never know that. He is so passionate about this project, passionate about increasing awareness of rock art, increasing the protection of them, the management of them, as well as increasing, he wants to share it with people. And we'll be assessing a site, and if tourists come, he'll stop assessing it to go talk to them, to tell them what that panel says, because he's excited about it, not because he's getting paid as a tour guide. And so it's that connection, and hopefully it will be a lasting impression through the Rock Art Tour, which will be continued to validate the research that has been done so far. So all that to say, Wadi Rum is a magical place with all sorts of interesting critters, but even more enchanting people. And so by incorporating these people, by not suppressing but celebrating local knowledge and enhancing it for the betterment of future tourists, future children, like Muhammad teaching his daughter to read Thamudic. I mean, and that wasn't an oddity either. They were telling us, like, yeah, there's only 9 of us on the crew, but the whole village is talking about it. That kind of excitement, you can't force that. You can't create that. You can't make a community care about something. And so the fact that they do care, and now they know what they can do to participate in managing it, protecting it, and assessing it. It's giving them the skills to do things that they already wanted to do in the first place. So with that, I would definitely like to acknowledge the WRPA, the Wadi Rum Protected Area, Aziza, as well as ACOR and SHEP and USAID for supporting this project and inviting us to participate, and I'm honored to be part of this project, as well as we wouldn't be here without our team, without our documentation team, without the core team, without these kids. They're essentially kids, they're high school graduates, and it's astounding how passionate they were to be involved in this. And so it's been an honor, and I'm excited for the next step. So thank you and shukran.